About 980 years ago today, written in 1950, Go Rajaksarivarma Perantaka Sundara Chola King was an unparalleled emperor in the south. He ascended the throne 12 years before the time of our story. Over the centuries, the power of the Cholas grew stronger day by day. The Chola Empire spread in all four directions. However, by the time Sundara Chola came to power, the enemies in the south and north had become stronger. Kandaratatha, who ruled before Sundara Chola, was steeped in Shiva devotion and was famous as Sivana Kandaratatha. He was not so concerned about expanding the kingdom. His brother Aranjire, who succeeded Kandaratathar, remained on the throne for 1 year. After he had taken to Aotearoa in Thondai Nadu, Emperor Sundara Chola had all the best qualities that an emperor should possess. The warlike Sundara Chola invaded the south at the very beginning of his reign. A great battle was fought between the Chola and Pandyan forces at Soer. The Sinhalese king Mahinda had sent a large army to support Veera Pandyan, who was then the king of Madurai. A mighty army of Cholas defeated the Pandyas and the Sinhalese army at Sava. Disbanded, hairless and helpless, Veera Pandyan fled the battlefield for his life. He spent time hiding in a mountain cave in the middle of a milky land. The Elam army was almost annihilated in the Battle of Sava. In this way, the Sinhalese kings intervened in the wars between the Pandyas and the Cholas and sent help to the Pandyas. Emperor Sundara Chola wanted to abolish this custom completely. So he sent a Chola sainyam to Sri Lanka to teach the Sinhalese kings. Kajumbalar sent a large army to Sinhala under the command of a commander named Paranthakan Smallvelan, who belonged to the Kiratarazar family. Unfortunately, the Chola army did not reach Sinhala at once. It does not have the necessary shipping facilities. The first army marched boldly forward without thinking ahead. A Sinhalese army led by Mahindaraja's general Sena unexpectedly arrived and cornered the Chola army. A terrible war took place. In it Parantha, the Chola commander, he became famous in the historical inscriptions as Paranthakan, who was enslaved by Elam. When this news reached Veera Pandyan, who was hiding in a mountain cave in the desert, Amanis came out boldly again. Again he gathered a large army and fought. This time the Pandya army was in danger and Veera Pandyan also had to give up his life. Adita Karikalar, the first son of Sundara Chola, stood in the forefront of this war and performed heroic deeds. He also attained the title of Veera Pandyan headed Gopar Kesari. However, the desire to teach a good lesson to the Sinhalese king Mahinda was not only in the minds of the Sundara Chola emperor but also in the minds of all the Chola generals, vassals, and army soldiers. A large army was also prepared for the invasion. The question arose as to who would lead it. Sundara Chola's eldest son, Aditha Karikalar, the crown prince, was on his way to the north at that time. Tirumunapati was making the ancient city of Kanchi his abode after defeating and driving out the dual zone forces, Rashtrakutas, who had been dominating the country and Thondai Mandal for some time. He was also preparing to invade the north. In this situation, there was great competition among the other generals of the Chola country to lead the Elam region. Jealousy and exclusion arose from competition. It is wonderful to see a person who wanted to escape without going to war in the old country. The competition is about who goes to the battlefield. Jealousy and enmity sometimes develop from it. At this time, competition broke out among the Chola leaders as to who would go to Eland and take revenge on Mahinda and establish Chola's valor. Aromas Hivarmar, the young son of the Sundara Chola king, came forward to completely eliminate this rivalry and pacify everyone. "Father, I have grown up as a pet among my aunts and grandmothers in the old palace. Appoint me as the leader of the southern army. I am going to Sri Lanka to lead the Elam war," Ilongo Aromas Hivarmar said. Aromas Hivarma was only 19 at that time. He was the wealthy son of Sundara Chola, a favorite child of all the queens who lived in old palaces. He was the darling of the Chola nation. King Sundara Chola was a good-looking man. His father Arunkar married Kalyani, a girl of the Vaithumbarayar dynasty who were enemies of the Chola clan, after seeing her mane of beauty and marrying him. Born to Arun K.R. and Kalyani, Sundara Chola was given the name Paranthakar by his parents. Seeing the wildness of his appearance, the countrymen and townspeople called him Sundara Kalar, and that became the name given by all. All children born to such a person are beautiful. But the last born Aromas Hivarmar surpassed everyone in beauty. The beauty that shone upon his face was not only that of mankind, divinity was appropriate. When he was a child, the queens of the Chola dynasty used to kiss him and make his cheeks grow. Kundave Prati was his daughter who was most fond of him. Although she was 2 years older than Arulmazai, Kundave Prati thought that the responsibility of raising her younger brother was on her head. Arulmazai also had a similar request with Kundave. The brother does not cross the line that he has set himself. It is enough for Ilaya Prati to say a word, on the contrary, even if Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva came together and said, Arulmaz Hivarma would not care. She often stares at her brother's face. Not only when he is awake but also when he sleeps, she keeps an eye on him. This child has some divine power. It is my responsibility to bring it out and shine. She thinks that. She often looks at the palms of her brother when he sleeps. The lines on those hands appear to her as a conch wheel shape. Aha! Wasn't he born to rule the world under the shadow of an umbrella? She will think that. But there is no room for thinking that he will climb the Chola throne. He had two seniors, those worthy of title. Then, from where will the kingdom come to him? On which throne will he ascend? Gods will somehow, who saw? The world is so vast, there are so many nations and so many kingdoms in this world. Haven't we heard in stories and epics about people who went from one country to another and ruled the kingdom due to the prowess of Pujabala? Did the government not understand that the prince who was chased from Bengal, where the Ganges River flows, went to Sri Lanka on a boat? Didn't the Sinhalese dynasty last for 1,000 years? In this way Kundave Prati was thinking restlessly. Finally, when there was a discussion about who would be the commander of the army to be sent to Sri Lanka, she came to the conclusion that Arulmazai was the right one. Brother, Arulmazai. It is so difficult for me to be separated from you even for a moment. However, the time has come for me to ask you to go. You must go as the leader of the Sri Lankan army. She said. The prince happily agreed to this. Arulmaz Hivarma's heart was beating when he would escape from the palace life and the warmth of the Matar Asis. She has asked herself to go now. What is the barrier? If Kundavadevi puts her mind to it, there is nothing to do in the Chola Empire. Sundara Chola Emperor was so fond of his Selvak Kumari, so much hope. Ilongo Arulmaz Hivarman became the Matanda hero of the South Chola Sainyam. He also went to Ceylon, where he led the army and waged war for some time. But the war is not easily over. His style of warfare was different from that of others. All the logistics and funeral arrangements did not arrive properly from the motherland as he required. So he had come to the motherland once in between. He told his father and made all the arrangements according to his wish. He prepared to go to Elam again. Kundavadevi had organized auspicious events in the main mansion of Padayare to send Arum at Tambai to the battlefield. When Arulmaz Hivarma left the palace courtyard, the victory trumpets rang out, unions protested, drums sounded, cheers filled the air. All the mothers of the Chola clan blessed the darling child of the palace, put the enchanted water on his forehead and sent him on his way after Drishti. In front of the palace gate, where Arulmaz Hivarma had to go down to the footpath, Kundavadevi's female friends stood carrying golden plates with lamps in their hands. If girlfriends are normal, belonged to the families of the famous princes of the south. They had considered it a privilege to work for Sembian Mathavi and to be a friend of Kundave Prati in the Palyara Palace. Among them was Vanathi, the daughter of the small Velan of Kajumbalur. Seeing the prince approaching at a short distance, all the girls became agitated. When the prince came near, they gathered around the plates they carried in their hands. Then Vanati's entire mane suddenly trembled. The plate in the hand slipped and fell down, making a thnar sound. Damn! What an omen this is! the thought was formed in everyone's mind. But everyone was relieved to see that only the wick was burning even after the plate had fallen. "This is a very good omen," said the old men. Ilongo Aromas Hivarmar went upstairs after seeing the woman who slipped the plate in panic and confusion for no reason. When he went beyond, Venati also fainted and fell down. "Ah! The thought that we have done such a mistake made Venatha faint like that." At Kundave's command she was carried by the other women and laid on a platform in a room. Kundave Prati did not even stop to see her brother's departure and went inside and tried to relieve Venatha from fainting. Aromas Hivarmar, who saw Venatha collapsed while standing at the door, before getting on his horse, asked, "How is the woman who has fallen? Has she fainted?" He sent a man to inquire. Kuntavai Devi said to the person who came to inquire, "Sister! Who is this girl? What is her name?" Ilongo asked. "Kajumbalarch is the daughter of a petty farmer, her name is Venati. She is of a somewhat timid disposition," said Kundave. "Aha! Now I know the reason why she fainted. This girl's father himself went to Sri Lanka and died in the battlefield and never came back? It seems she thought of that," said the prince. "Perhaps, but don't worry about her. I'll take care of it. Go to Sri Lanka and come back victorious soon. Message me often," said Ilai Aprati. "All right, send me word if anything special happens here," Ilongo said. At this moment, perhaps due to the glory of the prince's sweet voice, Venatha began to recover from her fainting spell. Her eyes opened slightly at first. His eyes widened when he saw the prince in front of him, then the face also blossomed. Her coral cheeks were sunken in a smile. When consciousness came, so did Nam, and she suddenly sat up. She looked back, she blushed knowing that she was being supported by Ilai Aprati, and in a moment she remembered everything that had happened. "Sister! Have you done this?" she said with tears in her eyes. Before Kundave could reply, the prince said, "Don't you worry about that, Venathi. Mistakes happen to anyone. And there's a big reason why you're doing the same, that's what I was telling the young Prati," said. "Venati has doubts whether what he sees is true and what he hears is true. Is the prince talking to me, who usually goes without looking at women? Is he comforting me? What do you call my privilege? Aha! The body is crawling. I feel like fainting again," the prince said. "Sister. The troops are waiting, I am on my way. When you send me a message, tell me how this girl is doing. Take good care of this fatherless girl." After saying that, he left. Kundavadevi's other female friends were watching and listening to all this from the upper floors through televisions. Jealousy started burning in their hearts. From that day Kundave Prati started showing special love to Venathi. She kept it to herself without sharing. She also taught her the education and arts she had learned. She even took her wherever she went. Kundavadevi often took Venatha to the palace Nandavan and talked intimately with her. She told her all the dreams she had had of her younger brother's future greatness. Venati also listened to all that with difficulty. After the above incident, Venatha lost consciousness and fainted 4 times more. At that time Kundave Prathi treated her properly and brought her back to consciousness. Venatha wakes up crying "Vimi Vimi" when she faints. "What, you bastard? Why are you crying like this?" Kundave asks. "I don't know, sister. I'm sorry. She is called Venathi." Kundava hugs her and consoles her. All this made the other women more and more jealous. So, isn't it natural that after Kunthi and Venatha got into the chariot and went to the home of the astrologer, the women talked about the above?